I am Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Ramakrishnan, tutor for physics. Today I'll be covering the chapter laws. Yesterday we did motion in a straight line. Today we are going to do motion in a plane. Briefly I'll run through how to access the revision notes and the test in Clay6 website. First of all, what you need to do is to go to the clay6.com website. Okay, so there you go on and click on this practice. Okay, now choose your package. See, you have all the tests here. Now go to the NEET premium tests. There you have the revision notes. Okay, you also have the tests for physics, chemistry, biology, and the NEET full tests also. We'll come back to the test later once I finish off the explanation part. We'll go to the revision notes now. Okay. So I told you we are now going to start with motion in a plane. Before that, I stopped with. Yesterday I stopped with body. Instantaneous velocity and everything. Today I stopped with broad body projected vertically upwards, the motion under free fall. So now I said I'll do relative velocity today. So what do you mean by relative velocity? Then if you are asked to define relative velocity is nothing but the relative velocity of object 2 with respect to object 1 when both are in motion is the time rate of change of position of object 2 with respect to the object 1. Okay, so if I explain relative velocity, say this is object 1 starting from this point, say this is object 1 and this is object 2 starting with this point. Both are now going in the same direction. Okay, so suppose they are now going on the same direction. Say, let us say this velocity is now going to be VA vector, and for this it is now going to be VB vector. We can see that, see the relative velocity. If VA and VB are the relative velocities of object A and B, then relative velocity of A with respect to B is given by VA minus VB. So you represent, whenever we write VAB vector, it means they are now going to be relative to each other, and it is given by VA minus VB. Okay, so now you all would have experienced rainfall. So what is going to be the relative velocity of rain with respect to a moving man? So let us take the velocity to be Vm, which is going to be the velocity of man. So let it be in the direction OA vector. And let Vr vector be the rain falling down vertically with velocity. Let the velocity V be Vr. That is, let it be in the OB direction. Okay. So therefore, it is now, I can explain like this. So suppose this is now going to be, so if this is now going to be the velocity of man going Vm, okay, this is now going to be Vr, velocity which is now going to be falling vertically downwards. So if this is now going to be OA vector, this is now going to be OB vector. Okay, so the resultant velocity is now given by, velocity of rain with respect to man is given by Vr squared plus Vm squared plus 2VrVm. If the since it is now going to be at 90 degrees, we take this to be its cos theta. Since the velocity is now going to be at 90 degrees, we take it as Vr squared plus Vm squared, where tan theta is now going to be equal to Vm by Vr. Okay. So how to solve whenever you are given a problem? Before that, let me also quickly go through the how to, yeah, before that let me go through that one second. Okay, so determination of relative velocity VA with respect to VB, I can also write it as VAB vector is equal to VAB vector is equal to root over VA squared plus VB squared plus 2VA VB cos of 180 minus theta, cos of, I'll put it here, 180 minus theta. Okay, so you know cos of the second quadrant is negative, right? So I can simply write this as root of VA squared plus VB squared minus 2VA VB cos theta. You can simply remember this formula for relative velocity of VAB with respect to VA with respect to B. Okay, so there are two special cases when cos theta is now going to be zero. When theta is now going to be equal to zero, now cos, you know, cos theta is equal to one, so that becomes VAB vector is equal to root over VA squared plus VB squared minus 2VA VB. Okay. It's simply, now you can see this is now going to be simply of the formula A squared plus B squared minus 2AB. So, which is nothing but root of VA minus VB the whole squared. Now, taking the square root, I can now simply write it as VAB vector is equal to VA minus VB. Okay, simply you can write it as VA minus VB. Suppose if the angle theta is now going to be theta 180 degrees, if this is now going to be 180 degrees, how do you write this? So VAB vector becomes, you can as well clear this. Okay, let me write it here. Yeah. VAB vector is equal to root over VA squared plus VB squared minus 2VA VB cos of 180 degrees. But cos of 180 degrees, you all know it is minus 1. So you can simply write it as root over VA squared plus VB squared minus. Now, you know, cos of 180 is minus 1, so now becomes minus of minus becomes 2 plus VA VB. Okay, so this is nothing but this is the form A squared plus B squared plus 2AB. So when you take out the root, it is now going to be simply VA plus VB. So VAB. So you can now simply remember this way, like when the bodies are now moving along a parallel straight line in the same direction, it is now going to be VA minus VB. Okay, this is now going to be for same direction, remember. Okay. And when they are now going in the opposite direction, then you say it is now going to be VA minus VB. This is for opposite direction. So remember these formula. Okay. Now coming back to the rain problem. Okay. Yeah. So problems which are related to rivers, like swimming across a river or rain problem, you can use these formula, the relative velocity here. So when you are going to solve a river problem, the minimum distance of approach, you can see, is now going to be the resultant of VA and VR should be V vector along OB. Okay, and sine theta, you know, is VR by VM, where V is going to be, V is the resultant, which is now going to be Vm squared minus Vr squared, and T is equal to D over, where T is now going to be minimum time approach. Okay, so T is now going to be D by root of Vm squared minus Vr squared. Suppose if T is now going to be the minimum time approach, then it is given by D by Vm. Okay, and man should swim perpendicular, so T, then it is now going to be perpendicular to the river flow. Then he will reach C instead of BC. Then VR by VM dot D. Okay. So this is how you do. You have to remember the problems related to rivers and rainfall. Okay. Anyways, I'll be solving such problems when I do the tests. Okay. And then you'll understand. When you do more and more problems related to this, you'll understand it better. Okay, now coming to the motion of a plane. As I told you, motion of a plane, again, you can expect, questions expected can be 1 to 2. Again, the percentile, weightage percentile for this particular chapter is 1.5 again. So be prepared, even though you might think only 1 or 2 problems, but it is got weightage. Definitely one problem will come from motion of a plane. So you have to be prepared. So generally, what are we going to cover in motion in a plane? So when I say motion in a plane, it is more like the plane, you know, it is now going to be in space. It is now going to have all the 3 components, that is the I, J and K component. If it is now going to be a vector, or X, Y and Z axis, when it is going to be a coordinate. Okay, that means it is now going to have X, Y and the Z coordinate. Before that, let me go about the vectors. Here we need to know about the scalar quantity. I mean, we already saw about the scalar quantity and the vector quantity. Now let us go with the multiplication. So when I talk about the addition and subtraction of vectors, let me go here. Yeah. When I talk about the addition of vectors, A vector plus B vector, it is simply, you can just add the algebraic sums. Say I and I can be added, J and J can be added, and K and K can be added. So it is now going to be simple. And when we talk about the subtraction, that is also going to be very simple. You can subtract the respective vectors, that is I and I, J and J, and K and K, the components. But when it comes to the multiplication part, you have 2. That is A vector dot B vector, which is now going to be the scalar. This is called as the scalar product. Okay, this is called as the scalar product. Same way, A vector cross B vector is now going to be the vector product. Okay, that is called as the vector product. So the formula for A dot B is now going to be modulus of A, modulus of B, cos theta. Okay, and A cross B, the vector multiplication is going to be modulus of A, modulus of B, sin theta, n cap, where n cap is going to be the unit vector perpendicular to this. Okay. Okay. Now coming back to the projections. Yeah. Here it is. Projective motion. Yesterday we were talking about this projective motion. I told you how an object is now going to experience a free fall. So whenever it is now going to be under the influence of free fall, I told you it is now going to be under the influence of acceleration due to gravity. Right? So we can recall that here. So you have to remember the formula. Okay, let me explain that to you. Yeah, now projective motion, it is now going to be more like, yeah, this is, there are 2 types of motion. That is, one is now going to be the oblique motion, and the other is now going to be the motion on the horizontal projection. 2 types of projectile motion you have to understand. One is the horizontal projection and the other is the oblique projection. So when I talk about the horizontal projection, we can as well use the formula which I taught you yesterday. Let us quickly recall that, okay? So that we'll be doing the problems related to that. So let me quickly recall what we did yesterday. Like you have to remember T is equal to root of 2H by G, time taken, okay? And okay, so suppose, let us say that this is now going to be the tower by which the object is now going to be thrown like this. This is the horizontal projection. Here we can see this is now going to the place at which the point from the start, that means the foot. Okay, this point, let me mark this as A. So if this is, this is called as R, the range. Okay, the horizontal range. Horizontal range is given by R is equal to U root of 2H by G. Okay, remember this. P is equal to root of 2H by G, and R is, where T is the time of flight. Okay, where T is called as the time of flight, and R is now going to be the horizontal range, which is given by U times root of 2H by G. Okay, remember, the velocity always is now going to be resolved into two components, that is one along the x axis, that is Vx, and one along the y axis, that is Vy. Or you can even tell it as Vx cos theta and Vy sin theta, because this always, you know, in a we always consider whenever the object is moving along the x axis, we take that as cos theta, and the velocity whenever it is now going to be along the y axis is, you take it as the motion along the y axis is taken as sin theta. So we can resolve this as Vx sin theta and Vy cos Vx cos theta and Vy sin theta. So what will be the resultant velocity? This is now going to be the resultant velocity, right? This is going to be the resultant velocity. That is now given by V is equal to root over Vx squared plus Vy squared. Remember that, okay? Or in other words, this is now going to be Vx is now going to be, when I take Vx as the initial velocity U, that is U squared, then V is Vy is now going to be Gt, then it is now going to be G squared T squared. So the resultant velocity V is given by root over U squared plus G squared T squared. Remember, okay? And of course, the tan theta is now going to be given by, if beta is now going to be the angle, then you say that it is now going to be, suppose say this is now going to be beta. Okay, the angle is beta. Then tan beta is given by Gt by U, Y by X, right? Or B is equal to tan inverse of Gt by U. Is it clear? Now coming to the, yeah. So we were talking about, now coming to the oblique projection. Yeah. T is equal to X by U cos theta, and R is equal to U squared sin theta by G, and M is given by U squared sin squared theta by 2G. Okay. Now, As I said, T is now going to be the time of flight. R is now going to be the, so this is now going to be the range, okay? And maximum, M stands for T maximum, or maximum height of the projectile, that is now going to be given by, I can say this is now going to be nothing but the, this is nothing but the maximum height. H max, you can even put it as H max. If you can remember M, you can take it as M, or you can take it as H max, which is equal to U squared sine squared theta by 2G. Okay. Now, next coming to the equation of the trajectory of the projectile, that is given by Y is equal to X tan theta minus G by 2 U squared 2 cos squared theta X squared. So when the angle of projection changes from theta to 90 minus theta, then it becomes sine theta, right? You know, it always changes from sine, cos theta is changes from, cos of 90 minus theta is now going to be sine theta. You can as well use that formula, sine squared theta, okay? Now for maximum range R max, theta has to be 45 degrees. So R max is equal to U squared by G. Then H max will be R max by 4. So maximum height reached is when the range is maximum. Whenever the range is maximum, you can see that the maximum height has reached. Okay. Now coming to the horizontal projection, that is what we saw. We saw the formula earlier. So T is equal to 2H by G. R is equal to U times root of 2H by G. And velocity when it hits the ground is now going to be Vg is equal to V root of U squared plus 2GH. So these are the formulae you have to learn carefully. Okay. So I think I covered everything. Now let us quickly go to the problems. Okay. Yeah. I'll clear this. we'll go to the tests. So here we'll have to see that if you want to take the test, what you do is go to the site. Here you have physics, chemistry, biology, and all the neat tests, full tests also. Click on the physics tests. Now we are doing kinematics, right? So I told you yesterday, motion in a plane and motion in a straight line are clubbed together as kinematics. Both the two topics are clubbed as kinematics. So this here, the blue bubble indicates that you have not done the test. Okay, you have not taken that test. And R is now going to be the red bubble is now going to be the random test which you can take. The green bubble says that you have already taken the tests. And the yellow bubble says it is an incomplete test. Okay, you can take the test. You can continue the test. You can as well take the test any number of times. Even if you have done once, it doesn't mean that the test is ended there. You can take it any number of times. Now let me go to the fifth test. Okay, I'm going to take the test. Click the take test. Go to test. Now it starts here. A particle starts from rest from top of an inclined plane of a given base. The time of fall is least when the inclination of the plane to the horizontal is what? We have to find out the angle. Okay. Let us solve that. Okay. Let me draw the diagram. So this is now going to be the triangle. Something's wrong. Okay. Let me take this as A, B, and C. Let this angle be theta. Okay. Now you know the base is given as this is given as A. Okay. Now A by AC is given by. Now you know what is cos theta? Okay. Let us go from the beginning. Cos theta is equal to A by AC, or you can say AC is equal to A by cos theta. Okay. Now the body travels along AC. Okay. The body is traveling along this AC here. So the component of G along AC is now going to be here. We are the component which is now going to be acting is now going to be G sine theta. Okay. The component of G along AC is now going to be G sine theta. Now quickly, let us use the formula. You now you have to remember the laws of equations of motion, which we studied earlier under free fall. Okay, the body is now going to be under the influence of gravity, so you'll have to take the equations which we studied under free fall. Okay, so S is equal to ut plus half gt squared. Okay, half gt squared. Now u is zero. Initial velocity is zero. So it is now going against gravity. That is why we have taken it as plus only. So S is equal to ut plus half gt squared. Since it is now going to zero plus half into, I can take the g component is now going to be g sine theta into t squared. Okay. So we want t. Okay, so now you know S is going to be A, so T is equal to root over 2A by G into sine theta cos theta. I've just substituted and simplified because we have the time restrictions. I'm not doing it elaborate. You can as well understand. So it is now going to be root of 2A by G sine theta cos theta. But you know, sine 2 theta is now going to be 2 sine theta cos theta. So what I'll do is I'll write it as root over 2A by G into half of sine theta cos theta. Okay. Or that is now going to be equal to sine 2 theta. So this is now going to be equal to root of 2A by G into sine 2 theta. Is that clear? So when theta is minimum, sine 2 theta is 1, you know that. Right? When is minimum? When it is now going to be minimum? Whenever it is now going to be sine 2 theta is now going to be 1. That means 2 theta should be equal to 90 degrees or theta should be equal to 45 degrees. Okay. T is minimum when theta is 45 degrees. Okay. Let us click which option? B option is correct. So let us click that. Quickly go to the second one. Two frictionless inclined planes making angles 30 degrees and 60 degrees with a vertical are shown. Two blocks A and B are placed on the two planes. So we've got two inclined planes and A and B are now going to be placed on that. What is the relative vertical acceleration of A with respect to B? That is being asked and the options are here. Let us quickly solve that and find out which option is now going to be correct. Let me clear this. Now A is, let A be the acceleration of the inclined plane, which is now going to be G sine theta. Vertical component, component of the acceleration, let the vertical component of acceleration be G sine squared theta. Okay. G sine squared theta. Therefore, relative acceleration of A with respect to B is now going to be G times sine squared 60 minus sine squared 30. You can simply substitute the values, simplify, and see that it is now going to be G into, so G into sine squared 60, sine, you know, sine 60 is root 3 by 2. So it becomes 3 by 4 minus sine squared 30 is half, you know, that is now going to be, which is nothing but, yeah, that is now going to be 3 by 4 minus 1 by 4, which is equal to 2 by 4, which is equal to half. So G into half, which is equal to G, you know, it is 9.8 into half, which is equal to 4.9 meters per second. So let's see which option is correct. So 4.9 meters per second squared. So option D is correct. That is going to be in the vertical direction. So there are two options which can confuse you. One is going to be the horizontal direction. You should be smart enough to select D because it cannot be in the, G cannot be in the horizontal direction. So it should be in the vertical direction. You can now think. Okay. Now going to this third one. Now coming, you have to recollect, I taught you the problems, how to solve the problems related to rivers. So let us see this. A river is flowing with a speed of 1 kilometer per hour. A swimmer wants to go to C. Starting from A, he swims with a velocity of 5 kilometers per hour at an angle of theta with respect to the river. So it is very clear in the diagram. And they have also given that AB is equal to BZ is equal to 400. Okay, they have given that AB is equal to BZ is equal to 400. So what can be the correct option? Time taken by the man is 6, which is going to be the correct option. Let us now quickly solve that. Okay. Yeah. So given B is equal to 5 kilometers per hour. Okay. And AB is equal to, obviously, you know, it is now going to be 5 sine theta. Okay. And BC is equal to 5 cos theta. Because BC is along the x axis. So we can take it as 5 cos theta plus 1. Okay. Because it is now going to travel at the rate of 1 kilometer per hour. So we have to take it as 1. So we can take now this as, I'll rearrange and write. Now, you know, this is now going to be the resultant velocity is now going to be the addition of both the components. So this is because they are now going to be. So now we can say that 5 sine theta minus 5 cos theta is equal to 1. Okay. Or I can write it as, I'll take the phi as the common factor. So I'll write it as sine theta minus cos theta is equal to 1 by 5. Okay. Now, you know, sine theta, I can write cos theta as root of, sorry, minus 1 minus cos sine squared theta. I can write cos theta as 1 minus cos squared theta is equal to 1 by 5. Now, quickly simplify, square and simplify. Now, you can see that you'll get a quadratic equation. I know you're all well aware, so I'm not doing elaborately. I'm just doing the simply, you can square and simplify and finally you get the equation 50 sine squared theta minus 10 sine theta minus 24 equals 0. So now you can use the quadratic formula minus b plus or minus root of b squared minus 4ac by 2a to solve this. And then you can see that sine theta is now going to be equal to 4 by 5. Sine theta is equal to 4 by 5. So what is time now? T is equal to AB by pi sine theta. Okay, pi sine theta, which is nothing but since 400 meters. Now we are going to convert it to kilometers per hour. So that is now going to be 0.44400 divided by 5 into 4 by 5, which gives you 1 by 10. This is 1 by 10 hour. Now converting to minutes, 1 by 10 times 60, which gives you 6 minutes. So let's see which option is correct. Yeah, A is correct. Pick that. Go to the next question. A man holds 4 balls 180 meters above the ground and drops them at regular intervals of time so that when the first ball hits the ground, fourth ball is just leaving his hand. At this time, the second and the third balls from the ground are at positions. Okay, so we have to find out the position of the second and the third balls. Okay, let me solve this. Okay. Time taken for the first ball to reach the ground is now going to be t is equal to root of 2h by g. Okay. Substitute root of 2 times 180 by g. Let us take g as a whole number 10. Okay. Instead of 9.8, we'll take it as 10, which is equal to 6 seconds. So I can draw the position of balls like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the first ball, second ball, third ball, and the fourth ball. Okay, this is now going to be. Now this is the height between the first and the second. Let us take this as h1. Okay, and this as h2. First and the second, let us take that as h2. Okay. Now time interval between the first balls is 2 seconds. He says so. That is h1 is equal to half g into 4 square. Okay, which gives you 80 meters. At same way, for the second, it is now given as for 2 seconds. So it is now going to be H1 is equal to, sorry, that is H2. So H2 is now going to be half G into 2 square, which gives you 20 meters. Okay, so what is now going to be the height? So height from the ground, you have to calculate from the ground, right? So it is now going to be 180 for this is now going to be 180 minus 80, which is equal to 100 meters. And for the second position, it is now going to be 180 minus 20, which is equal to 160 meters. So which is the correct option? 160 and 100. So A is the correct option. Save that and go to the next. The time taken by a particle to slide down a smooth inclined plane is double the time it would take in falling down along a height equal to the vertical plane, vertical height of the plane. The inclination of the plane with horizontal is what? Okay. Let us quickly solve this. Let me draw the diagram here. So let this be the inclined plane. Let this be the object which is now going to be moving along the inclined plane. Obviously, this is now going to be, G is now going to be this. So, it will have two components. One along this and one along this. That is G sine theta here. And this is now going to be G cos theta. And this is now going to be G. Okay. So, S is now going to be the distance. Now, let this angle be theta. Okay. Let this angle be theta. Now, you know, S is equal to half g sine theta into 2t the whole square. Okay. 2t square. Okay. Or now you know from this diagram, this is whole distance is x. So if I mark it as A, B, and C, AB is S and AC is H. Okay. AC is H and AB is S. So what is H by S? Nothing but sine theta. Okay. So you can write S to be equal to H by sine theta. All right. So T is now going to be the time taken to fall from the height H. Okay. So H is equal to, now already we have seen that in oblique projection, I mean horizontal projection, H is now going to be half GT square, right? So now simply substitute. So S is now going to be equal to half GT square divided by sine theta, which is nothing but half G sine theta into 4t square. I'm substituting the value of the value given. So I'm substituting, that is now going to give you 4 sine theta. So from this, you can see that it is now going to be sine square theta is equal to 1/4. S, you know that. So we have now substituting for S, and then we have found out S square, sine square theta is now going to be 1/4, or this implies sine theta is equal to half, which is equal to this. Therefore, theta should be equal to 30 degrees. Is that clear? I am quickly doing the simplification part. Of course, you can refer the problems and do the substitutions and simplify. You can get this, arrive at this. S is equal to half g sine theta into 4t squared, but we need t squared. So from that, we quickly found out sine squared is equal to 1/4, or from there we get it as sine theta is equal to half or theta is equal to 30. Let me see. So option A is correct. Click that and go to the next. Okay. A ball is dropped vertically from a height d above the ground. It hits the ground and bounces up vertically to a height d by 2, neglecting the air resistance. Its velocity v varies with height h above the ground as. Okay. This is quite simple. Now you can see that the graph between H and B will be a parabola. You can as well see here. See? Look into the graphs clearly now. Graph between H and B is now going to be a parabola. Now, you know, at H is equal to D, he says. So H is equal to D. Okay. And at H is equal to D, velocity is not the maximum height. You know, the velocity is now going to be zero. It is now going to be zero. Velocity is zero. Now, since it is now going in the downward direction, it is now G is now going to be. So you can take the height to be negative. Okay. The height is now going to be negative. Now, you know, its value, negative value keeps on increasing. That is, the G value keeps on increasing. Okay. So it goes on. Since it is now going to be in the downward direction, you can take it. So at H is equal to zero, you know, the velocity gets reversed. That means, once it reaches the maximum height, it is now, we saw that the velocity is zero, and then it is now going to come down. Once it comes down, it is now going to be in the downward direction. In that case, what happens? It is now going to keep increasing. Okay. So which can be the thing? So it is now going to be at zero. It is now going to be d by d. So obviously, you can see d by 2 at 0, right? And this is now going to be the, since you can see that it's also now going to be a parabolic graph. So it, C cannot be the correct option. It is now going to be in the downward direction. So obviously this cannot be the correct option. A also cannot be the option. So E should be the correct option. Okay. So save that. And a ball is projected horizontally with a speed V on top of a plane inclined at an angle 45 degrees with the horizontal, how far from the point of projection will the ball strike the plane? Okay. Let us solve this. Okay. Let me draw the diagram here. Let this triangle, let this. So this is now going to be the velocity V. Let us take this position, the angle is theta. This is going to be H, this position. Let us take B here, okay? And obviously, this is now going to be theta times T here. For horizontal projection for body with velocity V, we know that H is equal to half GT squared, right? Let X be the horizontal range, which is given by VT, okay? So the angle of inclination is given as 45 degrees. So since it is 45 degrees, you can see that h is equal to x. Okay, h is equal to x. So on equating, we get half gt squared is equal to b into t. Okay, b into t. Now you know t is equal to 2v by g. Okay, 2v by g, or I can take it as vx. Okay, vx. So now on equating, we get it as x is equal to b into 2v by g, which is nothing but 2v squared by g. Now you know AB is equal to x sin theta, or AB by x is equal to sin theta, or AB is equal to x sin theta. Okay, so this is AB is x by sin theta. Okay, so now substitute, that gives you 2V squared by G into 1 by sin theta. I'm substituting for x. Okay. Now you know sin theta is given, theta is given as 45, and sin 45 you know is 1 by root 2. So now this becomes 2v squared by g into root 2. Okay. Now let's see which option is correct. Yeah, you can see D's option is correct. So click that, go to the next. Let me clear the board. Yeah. Go to the next question. That is the seventh question. Yeah, this is what we did. Save and go. A body traveling along a straight line travels 1/3 of the total distance with velocity 4 meters per second. The remaining part of the distance was covered with the velocity 2 meters per second for half the time, and with velocity 6 meters per second for half of the other time. The mean velocity averaged over the whole time of motion is what? Okay, let's solve this. Okay, let us take the total distance as, total distance is equal to s. Now the time, let the time covered for the first 1/3 of the distance, 1/3 of the distance be equal to t1. Let it be t1. So what will be t1 now? T1 will be equal to s by 3 by 4, which is equal to s by 12. Let t2 be the time travel or when time taken for the next part of the journey. That is, it is now going to be 2s by 3, which is equal to 2t2 plus 6t2. Okay, that is equal to 8t2, which is now nothing but 8t2. Okay. But all so t2 is now you know, you can equate that, so that is going to be t2 is equal to, he says it's equal, they are now going to be equal, so now I can equate that to s. Okay, s by 12, so that is now going to be s by 12. So what is now the average velocity? Average velocity is the total distance by total time taken, which is now going to be, so I can write it as average velocity is equal to s by t1 plus 2t2. Okay, or s by t1 is s by 12. This is going to be 2s by 12. This is t2 is 2s, which is nothing but when you simplify and find out, you can see this now will be 4 meters per second. Let's see which option is correct. 4 meters per second. B option is correct. So save that. Go to the next one. A two, again, coming back to the relative velocity problem, you can see a 2 meter wide truck is moving with uniform speed of V0, which is equal to 8 meters per second along a straight horizontal road. A pedestrian starts to cross the road with a uniform speed of V when the truck is 4 meters away from him. the minimum value of V so that he can cross the road safely is 1. Let me solve this. Let me draw the diagram. So, Huck is here. Let us say this is going to move like this. Let this be the velocity V here. And let this angle be theta. So, he says this distance is 2 meters. Okay, this distance is 2 meters. So, mark it as AB. Okay, let this be C. And this distance is given as 4 meters. So, the man is moving along this dash. Okay, and the truck is now going to be here. Okay, truck is. Okay, let the man crossing the road. Now, he is crossing the road at an angle of theta degrees. So, for safe crossing, the man must cross the road by the time the truck describes a distance of 4 plus AC. Okay, 4 plus AC, or simply you can put it as 4 plus AC or 4 plus 2 cot theta. 4 plus 2 cot theta. So that gives you AC plus 4 divided by V0, which is equal to VC by V. Okay. Now equate both. Solve it. Now you know V0 is 8. So you can substitute in the place of A plus 4, you can substitute this 4 plus, so 4 plus 2 cot theta divided by 8 is equal to, BC is nothing but 2 by sine theta divided by V. We'll have to calculate V. So from this we get V is equal to 8 by 2 sine theta plus cos theta. So, for minimum time, we need to find out the minimum time. Okay, we have arrived at the equation. Now, in the mathematics part, you have studied about the maxima and minima. So, for to find out the minimum time, find out the dv by d theta. That has to be 0, equated to 0. That should be equal to minus 8 times 2 sine theta minus sine theta, sorry, 2 cos theta. I'm sorry. 2 cos theta minus sine theta divided by 2 sine theta plus cos theta the whole square. I've just differentiated V. Okay. Equated to 0. So you get 2 cos theta minus sine theta is equal to 0. Or this implies tan theta is equal to 2. Okay. Tan theta is equal to 2. So, quickly draw the triangle and see. You can see that this is now going to be 2. This is going to be 1. Obviously, it is root of 2 squared plus 1 squared. This is now going to be root 5. Okay. So, what is sine theta? Sine theta is now going to be 2 by root 5. Okay. Sine theta is equal to 2 by root 5. And cos theta is equal to 1 by root 5. So, therefore, substitute the values. B is equal to, therefore, B is equal to 8 by 2 times 2 by root 5 minus 1 by root 5, which is equal to 3.57 meters per second. 3.57 meters per second. Okay. 3.57 meters per second. Yeah. Let's see which option is correct. 3.57. Yes, C option is correct. Mark that. Go to the next question. Now look into this graph. This is a slightly complicated thing. He's asking a particle is moving in xy plane with y equals x by 2 and dx is equal to 4 minus 2t. The displacement versus time of the particle would be 1. Okay. Now you can see y is equal to, it is given that y is equal to x by 2 and dx is equal to 4 minus 2t. Okay, that is dx by dt is 4 minus 2t. Okay. So we can see that from the let me do it here so that you understand it. All right. So x is given as 4t, or dx is given as 4t minus, sorry, 4 minus 2t, right? That is dx by dt is given as this. Or I can write it as dx is equal to 4 minus 2t dt. Now integrate on both sides, I'll get it as x is equal to 4t minus 2t squared by 2, which is equal to 4t minus t squared. Okay. Now we have y is equal to x by 2, and y is equal to x by 2. Now substitute for that, then you get it as y is equal to 2t minus t squared by 2. Right? So s is, now you know s is going to be the resultant velocity, which is now going to be x squared plus y squared. Now substitute for that, you get it as root of x squared plus x squared by 4. That gives you root over 5 by 4x. Okay. Now equate that to 0, because it is now going to be the displacement, we have taken it to be 0. Now substitute. So 0 is equal to root of 5 by 2 times 4t minus t squared. Okay. So that gives you, from this you can infer that t is equal to 4 seconds. Okay. So obviously, looking into the graph, you can see this, it cannot be open. Just a second. Yeah, we were on the 10th problem, right? Yes. Yeah. Look into the graph. Now you can see that it is not a linear graph. Obviously, it cannot be a linear graph. Because at 4s, displacement is 0. So obviously, this is not touching the x-axis, so you cannot take the B option. So the option is now going to be between C and D. So it is now touching the x-axis. So you'll be wondering whether it is now going to be C or D. But it is not going to be linear. See, you cannot see it is not going to be linear. It is, so at first, it is now getting retarded, and then it is increasing. So what should be the D should be the correct option. So C should be the correct option. This is not going to be, because it is not a linear graph. At C, it is now touching the x-axis at 0. So obviously, C should be the correct option. Save that and go to the next. A particle is projected vertically from a point A on the ground. It takes time t1 to reach point B, but still continues to move up. It takes further t2 time to reach the ground from point B. The height of point B from the ground is 1. This is quite easy. Let me see. So let us take the time taken for the particle to reach the highest point B, t1 plus t2 by 2. Okay. Let us take that as t1 plus t2 by 2. Now we know B is equal to u minus gt squared. B is equal to u minus gt squared. Now the first velocity, let us take that as u is equal to g times, since u is equal to 0, now it is now going to be t1 plus t2 by 2. Okay. So now this is the height of B from ground is, now h is equal to, you know, it is now going to be ut plus half at squared. Okay. Or h1 is equal to, or h is equal to ut1 plus half at1 squared, which is equal to g into t1 plus t2 by 2 into t1 minus half g t1 squared. Or from this you can infer that h is nothing but half g into, after simplification you can see that it is now going to be g t1, half g t1 t2. Half g t1 t2. So D is the correct option. Click that and go to the 12th. Two particles start moving from the same point in a straight line. The first moves with constant velocity v and the second moves with constant acceleration a. During the time lapse before the second catches the first, the greatest distance between the particle is what? Let us quickly solve that. Now let x be the distance between the particles after t seconds. So let x1 be the distance. So x1 is equal to v times t. X2 is equal to half at squared. So now we know x is equal to x1 minus x2. So vt minus half, that is vt minus half at squared. Okay, half at squared. This is now going to be half. So for x to be maximum, dx by dt should be equal to zero, right? This implies v minus at is equal to zero. When you differentiate this, you get v minus at is equal to zero. This infers v is equal to v by a. Now substitute in t. So in this equation, okay. Now substitute in this equation. So what do you get? X is equal to, in the place of t, we are going to substitute v by a. So you get x is equal to v into v by a minus half a into v by a the whole square. So that simplifies to v squared by 2a. V squared by 2a. From this we can see which option is correct. V squared by 2a. B is option is correct. So click that. Go to the next. In a car race, A takes less time to finish than car B and passes finishing point with a velocity v0 more than the velocity of car B. And t0 time earlier than car B. Okay. The car starts from rest and travel with acceleration a1 and a2 respectively. Then the ratio of v0 by t0 is 1. Let's quickly solve that. Okay. Let s be the distance traveled by each car. Now let us say va. Let me clear that. Okay. Va is equal to root of 2a1s. Therefore, from this, we also know that since now you know v squared is equal, we are now getting this from the equation. V squared minus is equal to u squared plus 2as. And same way, vb, let us take vb is equal to root of 2a2s. Okay. And time t1 is now going to be equal to root of 2s by a1. Okay. And t2, let t2 be equal to root of 2s by a2. Okay. We get this from the equation s is equal to ut plus half at squared. Okay. Now we know what is v0. V0 is now going to be root of 2a1s minus root of 2a2s. Okay. And t0 is t2 minus t1, which is nothing but root of 2s by a2 minus root of 2s by a1. Okay. Which is nothing but t0. Okay. Now, therefore, v0 by t0 is being asked, which is nothing but root of a1 minus root of a2 divided by 1 by root of a2 minus 1 by root of a1. Simplifying this, we get this as root of a1 by a, root of a1, a2. Let's see which option is correct. D option is correct. Save that. Go to the next. A juggler maintains four balls in motion, making each of them raise to a height of 20 meters from his hand. What time interval should he maintain for the proper distance between them? Take G as 10 meters per second. Okay. Let's quickly solve that. Now for each ball, you know, v squared minus u squared is equal to 2as, okay? Or minus u squared is equal to, because the final velocity is now going to be 0, it is now going to be 2 times minus time 10 times 20. Or from this we infer u is equal to 20 meters per second, okay? Now we also know that v is equal to u plus 80. We also know that v is equal to u plus 80, okay? So that is 0 is equal to 20 minus 10t, or from this we infer that t is equal to 2 seconds. So the ball has to return to his hand so that the total time in 4 seconds, okay, is going to be 4 seconds. So each ball must be thrown at an interval of 4/4, that is 1 second, so that it can be maintained at a proper distance. Okay, let's see which option. Option D is correct. 1 second. Okay, save that. Going to the last one. At a height of 0.4 meters from the ground, the velocity of the particle projected at an angle is theta is V vector is equal to 6i plus 2j meters per second. The angle of projection theta is given by what? He is asking you to take g to be 10 meters per second. Let us quickly solve this. Let ux and uy be the initial component. Okay. Let ux and uy be the initial component of velocity. So v is given by, v vector is given by 6i plus 2j. So tan theta should be equal to uy by ux. Now vx is now going to be 6, he says, and vy is equal to 2, he says. Now you know ux is equal to vx, so ux is equal to 6, and now substitute dy squared is equal to uy squared minus 2gh, or now that is going to be equal to vy squared. Because it is now going to be upward motion, we can now take it as minus gh, it's going to be plus 2gh. Okay, since it's moving upwards. Now substitute the values, that is now going to be 2 squared plus 2 into 10 into 0.4. Okay, so that works out to be equal to 12. Okay, so vy is now going to be root of 12, which is equal to 2 root 3. Okay, now what is tan theta? Tan theta is given as 2 root 3 by 6, which is equal to 1 by root 3, or this implies theta is equal to 30 degrees. You know, tan 30 is 1 by root 3. So let's see which option is correct. Option B is correct. Save that. Now we have completed the test. End the test. The results will be loading. Yeah, you can see the results here. So since there was a technical error and then I had to come back again, so it shows that I had unanswered certain questions. So now look into this. So this says incorrect. I can as well click that and go to the explanation part. Now see, the explanation part is given here. So it is given as C is the correct answer. I marked C's. I think some error was there because we had to come again. So as well, you can verify your answers using the explanation part also here. Okay. So with this, we come to this, come to the end. Now you have the neat packages. Let me go to the neat packages. You can see, wait, let me, yeah. The neat packages, I have 38 full art length tests also and 15 original tests and 20 plus neat past papers. You can, all this come under one package and the revision notes are also included in that package. So you can get the additional help of by using our ask feature. You can have the, you can click this and ask any questions. You'll be supported by our by the chat support using the Telegram also, the Classic student help board. You can also get one-to-one classes with the tutors, or for other inquiries you can as well send me to info@classics.com. So the next lesson I'm going to take on Monday. Tomorrow's a holiday, so on Monday I'll be taking is laws of motion. Until then, bye from me, children. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.